And we pray God's richest blessing upon you as you sit under the ministry of his word. Now, we just finished singing Have Thine Own Way, Lord. And choosing that hymn, it was for a specific reason, because we're going to talk about the Father actually being the one who is the potter. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. And it's the Father who is the one who molds me. That was a beautiful hymn, and yet I've never really considered the fact of how doctrinally correct it really is. Fill with thy spirit till all shall see Christ only always living in me. So we're singing to the Father there. We're praying to the Father that his will be done. And this continues the theme that we have been considering with the Father's affection from 1 John chapter 3. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. So this morning, we are going to continue that study. This morning's message, and by the way, I should wish all of you fathers out there a happy Father's Day. I apologize for not doing that earlier. We're going to look at the affectionate attributes. That's the title of this morning's message. The affectionate attributes. And I'm going to try to do something that I don't know that in my many years, because I'm old, many years of preaching, I'm going to try not to use a New Testament portion of Scripture. Now, it's not that I don't think that the New Testament is important, obviously, but it was, I think, highlighted for me from the Lord that to want to look at the Father, the God the Father, from the Old Testament perspective this morning. There's no doubt that the New Testament reveals to us much more about the Trinity than the Old Testament does. We find the Trinity in the Old Testament, there's no doubt about that. But the relationship between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is highlighted more in the New Testament than in the Old Testament. I was going to kind of try to trick you, and I've done this on the past, or at least tried to trick you in the past, and ask you if you believe in progressive truth. And, you know, when you think of the word progressive, most of the time for those of us who are pretty conservative, we don't like the word progressive. But actually, we do believe in God progressing through each dispensation. And he progresses through each dispensation by giving more truth. Maybe I can explain that. I know Brother Steve just spoke upon this, and I'm trying to get that video uploaded onto our YouTube channel, hopefully this week. I know Brother Steve just talked about stewardship and dispensationalism the week we were on vacation. The truth that we are required, responsible for, is the truth from God's word. There is going to be more truth in the next dispensation that we are not responsible for. And I want you to think back about the dispensation mostly of the law is what we're going to look at. And we're really going to concentrate on how God introduced himself to the nation of Israel as Father. Okay, I'll say that again so we all get it. How God introduced himself to the nation of Israel as God the Father. I think it's fascinating when you think about the fact that God the Father is highlighted more than the Son and the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament. It was the Father who was highlighted for the nation of Israel. And that's what we want to look at, and I'm obviously very excited about that. Very interesting study, I hope, this morning. The 3 points that we're going to have for this morning's message: his adoption, speaking of the Father, it's his adoption, then we'll very briefly look at his attributes, and then his assurance. So that is the thoughts for this morning. the affectionate attributes. So let's go now in our study to his adoption, the first point. It is God who does the choosing. And I don't know that we'll look at all of these verses that I have up on the screen, but as our dear brother printed out the PowerPoint for you, you can look up these verses and read them in your own study, if you will. We want to talk about the fact that it's God who adopts us. Let me give you just a little bit of a understanding of who I am as a person. We grew up in a Christian home. I had a very discerning father, and I thank the Lord for him on this Father's Day. I thank the Lord for the foundation that he gave me in his discernment. And we used to, you know, drive to church together, ride to church together, and he would, you know, talk to us sometimes. And you may remember the little bumper sticker that said, I found it. Some of you may remember that, and it was a movement, and I was very young, don't remember much about it, but it was probably some type of new evangelical scheme to try to get people interested in religion again, and my father didn't appreciate that. Another one that he helped me with is there was I think it was a bumper sticker, it may have been a billboard, but it said, God said it, I believe it, and so it is so, is that what it said? God said it, what? Huh? That settles it, thank you. God said it, I believe it, that settles it. Now that sounds good, but I appreciate my father's discernment when when he said this, but he said that's not right. And he said, and I think with much discernment, he said it doesn't matter whether we believe it or not. God said it, and that settles it. And it was that type of discernment that I had growing up as a young man. And so I want you to understand that it's our Father who chose us. It's our Father who adopted us. Now, I believe in election. I believe in predestination. These are beautiful truths taught in Scripture. And I also know that the Bible teaches that God chose me not because of any attraction that I had to Him. He did it out of His love and His mercy. So let's turn to Deuteronomy. We'll look at the first one here, Deuteronomy chapter 7. It is God who chose us. I was thinking of that hymn, and I actually looked for it. I wanted to sing it, but I don't know that I could find it in our hymnals. I am His, and He is mine. I love that hymn. I think it's a beautiful hymn. I am His, and He is mine. But it doesn't say that He is mine and I am His. It says, I am His. And because I am His, He is mine. That's the divine order of things. Deuteronomy chapter 7, let's start in verse 6. It says, For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself. This is Moses speaking again to the nation of Israel, and that's our concentration this morning. The Father introducing himself as their Father above all that are upon the face of the earth. And then it says, The Lord did not set His love upon you, nor choose you, because you were more in number than any people, for ye were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you. And that's the only reason that the Lord gives. He looked upon the nation of Israel, and essentially he says, you were the smallest nation. He could have chose the Egyptian nation. He could have chose the Syrians, or he could have chosen any of these other nations that were on the face of the earth at the time. But he chose the smallest nation. And he says, the only reason that you need to know why I chose you is because I loved you. And because he would keep the oath which he swore unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of bondmen and out of the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keepeth his commandments to a thousand generations. Wow. So I just want to highlight the fact that he is the one who adopted us. There's not a person in this room, as a matter of fact, there has never been a person who is saved that woke up one morning and said, you know what, I think I'll get saved today. I think today is the day that I will get saved. I think that today is the day that I will choose God. That's not the way it works. It is God who starts working in our hearts. We are lost and on our way to hell, and it's God who starts knocking at our door. The Holy Spirit starts to speak to us. And if it was not for that, there is no way that we could be saved. Now, I believe that God does that to every person who passes the age of accountability. And many say no, but by his grace, we said yes. And when we said yes, we were adopted. Deuteronomy, I have a number of these here, and they all essentially speak about the Father and the Son. Turn with me, if you will, to Exodus chapter 4, verse 22. Exodus chapter 4. I want you to consider and as far as I know, this is the first time that God introduces himself as a father figure to the nation of Israel. Exodus chapter 4, it says, and thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son. Israel is my son, even my firstborn. And I just think that that is a wonderful, wonderful portion of scripture that introduces the nation of Israel. Can you imagine what that should have done, what that could have done and might have done for the nation of Israel? Here they are, a very small nation, a group of slaves, if you will, and they are in bondage to the nation of Egypt. And some man walks into their presence one day and says, God has said that I'm going to lead you out of this. Now, that should have been a comfort to them, and we know that it wasn't always. And we understand that because there are times when we should have great comfort and we don't. But we see here that this should have been a wonderful, wonderful truth given to the nation of Israel. When the Lord steps up and speaks up and says, Israel is my son. This is the first time, if I understand scriptures correctly, this is the first time that God introduces himself as the father of Israel. And what a time to do it as he begins extracting them, if you will, out of the nation of Egypt, out of the wicked bondage. I'm trying to, I don't want to look at all of these. Let's do turn to Deuteronomy chapter 31. Again, you can look these up. As the Lord leads, Deuteronomy chapter 31, and verse 6. It says, do ye thus requite the Lord, O foolish people and unwise? And then it says, is not he, speaking back to the Lord, thy father that hath bought thee and hath made thee and established thee? What wonderful truths about the father to the son, the nation of Israel. He bought thee, he made thee, and he established thee. He nourished them. These portions of scripture are so beautiful. Isaiah, let's do turn. We just read the, or excuse me, we just sang that wonderful hymn talking about being the potter and the clay. I would not be surprised if this is where it comes from. Turn to Isaiah chapter 45. Isaiah chapter 45. And we'll start in verse 9. Isaiah chapter 45, verse 9. Woe unto him that striveth with his maker. Again, get the idea here that God is the one who adopted us. God is the one who created us. He's the one who established us. He's the one who bought us. He is our Father. Let the potsherd strive with the potsherds of earth. Shall the clay say to him that fashioned it, what makest thou, or thy work? He hath no hands. Woe unto him that saith unto, and catch this phrase now, unto his father. So when we sang that hymn, thou art the potter and we are the clay, what we were saying essentially is, you are our maker, you are our father. What does that do to you? Is that, I hope, an encouragement to you? Woe unto him that saith unto his father, what begattest thou? Or to the woman, what hast thou brought forth? Thus saith the Lord, the Holy One of Israel, and his maker, ask me of things to come concerning my sons, and concerning the works of the work of my hands commanded ye me. I have made the earth and created man upon it. I, even my hands, have stretched out the heavens and are all their, and all their hosts have I commanded. I have raised him up in righteousness. I will direct all his ways. He shall build my city, and he shall let go my captives, not for price nor reward, saith the Lord. So we have this wonderful thought again of his adoption. Let's turn very quickly to 2 Samuel chapter 7. 2 Samuel chapter 7. This will be reiterated again. I have 1 Chronicles chapter 28 verse 6 up on the screen, and this is the sister portion to 2 Samuel chapter 7. This is the story when David is at the end of his life and he wants to build the temple for God. Okay, 2 Samuel chapter 7. Again, we're concentrating on God adopting us, us becoming his son, and the nation of Israel in the true truth of this. Let's start in verse 1. It came to pass when King sat in his house and the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth with curtains. And Nathan said unto the king, go, do all that is in thine heart, for the Lord is with thee. That wasn't the best advice. We know that. Nathan didn't give him the proper advice. Nathan, and it says now in verse 4, it came to pass that night that the word of the Lord came unto Nathan, saying, go and tell my servant David, thus saith the Lord, shalt thou build me an house for me to dwell in? Whereas I have dwelt in any house since the time that I brought up the children of Israel out of Egypt, even to this day, but I have walked in tents and in tabernacles. In all places wherein I have walked with the children of Israel, spake I the word with any of the tribe of Israel, whom I commanded to feed my people, saying, Why build ye not me an house of cedar? Verse 8, Now therefore, so shalt thou say unto my servant David, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took thee from the sheepcote, and from following the sheep to be a ruler of my people of Israel. And so we would consider this David's adoption, okay? And I was with thee whithersoever thou wentest, and have cut off all thine enemies out of thy sight, and have made thee a great name, like unto the name of the great men that are in the earth. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, that they may dwell in a place of their own, and move no more, neither shall the children of wickedness afflict them any more as before time. And as since the time that I commanded judges to be over my people, and have caused thee to rest from all of thine enemies, also the Lord telleth thee that I will make thee an house. So we have his adoption, if you will, in verses 8 and 9. And now I want you to think about this covenant that the Lord makes with him. This is called the Davidic covenant. I would be very careful to consider the fact that really any of the covenants that God made have much to do with you specifically. Covenants were made with the nation of Israel. And there are a lot of people who look back at the covenants and try to make them apply to you personally or to the church. And I would be careful. I would be very careful in doing that. Most of the covenants, we can see God's faithfulness, and in principle, we can apply them to our lives. But specifically, the Davidic covenant really doesn't have anything to do with us. It has everything to do with the nation of Israel and his future. Israel's future. And so God says in verse 12, And when the days be fulfilled that thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. And he shall build an house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. So who is he speaking about here? He's speaking about Solomon, obviously. Now listen to what he says in verse 14. This is the reason why we came to this chapter. He says, I will be his father, and he shall be my son. Is that a beautiful statement? When you think about what this must have meant to David, David is on his way out, and Solomon is going to be the one who will rule. And we know that Solomon is the one who will have peace in his reign so that he has time to build the temple for the Lord. But just think about this wonderful phrase. What this must have meant to David to know the reassurance that the Lord says to David, I will be his father and he shall be my son. What a phrase. What a truth. What a promise. What this must have meant. You know, when I think about the next generation, it would be easy for me to get worried. It really would. To think about what they're going to have to face after I die, if the Lord tarries. What's this world, what's America going to be after my generation dies? It could be quite upsetting. Except for you have truths like these in scriptures. That God will be just as faithful to the next generation as he has been to this generation and the past generations. Let's continue going on in verse 14. If he commit iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men and with the stripes of the children of men. And we know that that would happen. But my mercy shall not depart away from him, as I took it away from Saul. Did you catch that? That the Lord took the mercy away from Saul, whom I put away before thee. Thine houses and thy kingdoms shall be established forever before thee. Thy throne shall be established forever. Do you know who the Lord is speaking about when he says, thy throne shall be established forever? Do you know that there's going to come a day when the Lord Jesus Christ will sit on the throne of David for 1,000 years on this earth? This promise, again, not made to the church, not a covenant, not made necessarily to you and I as part of the church, but we can look forward to the time when Christ, who is the seed of David, will actually sit on David's throne for 1,000 years, and he will rule and reign on this earth. That's the Davidic covenant that the Lord is speaking to David about here. Yes, he is speaking about Solomon, but he is also speaking about the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, I'm going to stop there in that chapter. I would ask you to consider reading the rest of the chapter. When David's response to the Lord as his father is very, very beautiful, very, very precious, and I would ask you to consider reading the rest of that chapter. It would be a blessing to you, I know. But we're going to move on because of time, as usual. Okay, so we're going to leave his adoption. It's God who adopted the nation of Israel. It's God who chose the nation of Israel. And I hope that you can make the parallel truth into your life. It's God who adopted you. It's God who has chosen you. You are his son. You are his daughter. And I hope that that brings you wonderful comfort today. Okay, so we're going to move from his adoption to his attributes. And again, you have these in your printout. So I'm going to run through these very quickly this morning. The Father is the God of mercy. He is long-suffering, goodness, and truth. And of course, Exodus chapter 34, verse 6, and the Lord passed by. And I would want you to consider that this more than likely is the Father who is passing by before him and proclaim the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, abundance, goodness, and truth. This is when Moses asked to see the glory of God, and this is what Moses got to see. It's the Father and these wonderful attributes of him. The God of mercy, long-sufferingness, goodness, and truth. The Father is the God of forgiveness. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. He is the God of justice as well. Psalm 89, 13 and 14, thou hast a mighty arm, strong is thy hand, and high is thy right hand. Justice and judgment are the habitation of thy throne. Mercy and truth shall go before thee. He is the covenant-keeping God as well. Exodus chapter 19, verses 5 and 6. Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. For all the earth is mine, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. He is a covenant-keeping God. He is a redeeming God. Thus saith the Lord, King of Israel, his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first, I am the last, and besides me there is no God. Isaiah 44, 6. He is a faithful God. Lamentations chapter 3, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. And lastly, that's it. That's just some of his attributes. And I know I ran through those very quickly. What the point I'm wanting to make here is that the Old Testament stressed that it was the Father's attributes that the nation of Israel needed to understand and appreciate. Again, remember that the Trinity wasn't completely revealed until the New Testament had arrived and written. In the Old Testament, it was more the Father who was stressed. And I just want you to consider this wonderful truth that the nation of Israel, what they needed to succeed was that they had a father. And again, we just ran through his attributes very quickly. Okay. You're thinking, wow, he's on his third point and we still have 15 minutes. Well, you don't know that there's 52 verses in Psalm 89, do you? Huh? We do want to look at Psalm 89, and we are going to take the time to read the whole psalm. So we're going to think about his assurances here. His assurances. Thinking about the time that we live, it's been an interesting year, hasn't it? Very interesting year. I am almost 51 years old, and Alice thinks that's old. I don't remember a year like this. I wasn't around for World War II. I wasn't around to think of the Jews being exterminated, and I do remember that the 9/11 and that was definitely horrific. But this has been a very interesting year, a year of challenges for our nation, a year of challenges for the church. And I'm not the type of person who thinks that we have it worse than any other generation before us. I think we still have it pretty easy, as a matter of fact, in our lifestyle and the way that we live. You know, I don't remember any of us having straw taken away from us when we were building bricks. And yet there was a time when the nation of Israel was greatly oppressed. And we still have it pretty good in this country. So I'm not wanting for us to feel sorry for ourselves. But saying that, I also think that this could be a time where it could be a temptation for each one of us to lose our peace, to not have the wonderful peace that passeth all understanding. It has been a very, maybe even trying year, we could say, from some aspects. And I just want this last portion of Scripture to reassure you now that we have a Heavenly Father who is in complete control. Complete control. And I just think that this is a wonderful portion of Scripture that speaks to this. So let's start in Psalm 89. I want to introduce you, actually before we get into the psalm, I want to introduce you to Ethan. Ethan is the author of the psalm, and he is an Ezraite. And the only other Ethan of Ezraite that we can find in the Scriptures is in 1 Kings chapter 4. So would you hold your finger in Psalm 89. We'll be right back here. 1 Kings chapter 4. And verse 30. 1 Kings chapter 4, Verse 30, it says, and Solomon's wisdom excelled the wisdom of all the children of the east country and all of the wisdom of Egypt. And he was wiser than all men, and then it says, than Ethan the Ezraite. And so this is the only mention of an Ethan the Ezraite that I know of in Scripture. So it's very possible that Ethan is the author of this psalm in Psalm 89. Now, I don't want you to think that Ethan was a flunky. He was probably the second wisest man in all of Israel, second to Solomon. And so I just wanted you to know that. And maybe just get to know him just a little bit here as we begin this wonderful psalm. It is a psalm that I think is very appropriate to the time that we are living. I have the psalm broken up for us in a couple, four different parts, if you will. Praise for his covenant in the first four verses, a psalm for his character to verse 37, a plea for his chastening up to verse 45, and then the rest of the verses, a prayer for his ceaselessness. So let's just read the psalm and we'll just glean a few things from it. Remember that these are the assurances that you have a loving Heavenly Father. You have a loving Heavenly Father. It says, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. For I have said, mercy shall be built up forever. Thy faithfulness shall thou establish in the very heavens. I have made a covenant with my chosen. I have sworn unto David my servant. Thy seed will I establish forever, and build up thy throne to all generations, Selah. So a praise for his covenant, and again specifically, I've already mentioned that this is not the Abrahamic covenant or the Mosaic covenant. This is the Davidic covenant. This was a promise specifically to David that through Solomon's line, he would have a throne forever. What an assurance. Now, as an earthly father, I can't make any type of promises like this to my earthly children or to the people that I love. I don't have that sovereign ability. I can promise them that I can try to be the best father or role model that I can to them while I'm on this earth, but I've failed that. But just think of the Heavenly Father, our Heavenly Father, David's Father, Solomon's Father, who says, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. You will have a throne, and your seed will sit on that throne forever. What an assurance we should have. And it was very pleasant to go through the end of this week knowing what I was preaching on, and yet there were times where wait a minute, Mike. God is my Father. He's my Father. What do I have to worry about? You know, I was helping Brother Steve with a deck in the back of his house this week, and we were doing some work outside, and he said, you know, I knew you were coming over today, and so I was, he has a drain that he needed to get run out before we could put the deck up, and he said, you know, I spent some time last night really worrying about how we were going to figure all this out. And I laughed at him because within an hour we had it all figured out and was working on the deck, and it wasn't much of a big deal. And yet the story came to mind of Lois's grandfather. And I've been told this story down through generations where Pastor Minnick was walking down the hallway and he walked by the room of Pap, and Pap was in his room and he was crying. And, you know, being a concerning son, Pastor Minnick kind of stops and looks back and says, you know, Dad, what's the matter? And Pap there, sitting there, and I believe he was doing his devotions, and he says, you know, son, I'm just sorry I worried my way through life. And I'm 51, and I trust that I have more time left on this earth, and I hope that that will be my testimony, that I won't have to worry myself through life. Why? Because God is my Father. He's my Father. He's the one who chose me. He's the one who is fulfilling all the promises. I'm not making these promises come true. He's the one. And so we do want to, as with Ethan, who is praising him for the covenant, the Davidic covenant, let us praise our Heavenly Father for the assurance of the promises that we have had. Okay, so we have a lengthy portion of Scripture, probably the lengthiest portion of Scripture, where we have the psalm for his character. Through this portion of the Scripture, through this portion, verses 5 through 37, Ethan will mention numerous times aspects of the Father's character. Let's start in verse 5. The heavens shall praise thy wonders, O Lord, thy faithfulness. There's one of his characters also in the congregation of the saints. For who in the heaven can be compared unto the Lord? Who among the sons of the mighty can be likened unto the Lord? God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints, and to be had in reverence of all them that are about him. O Lord God of hosts, who is strong? There's another one of his characteristics, like unto thee, and to thy faithfulness, repetitive here, round about thee. Thou rulest the raging sea, when the waves therefore arise. Thou stillest them. Thou hast broken Rahab, and I don't want you to necessarily think about Rahab the person. I want you, as I studied this, and I did have to go back and study it, I want you to think about Egypt, the nation of Egypt here. Thou hast broken Rahab, thou hast broken Egypt in pieces as one that is slain. Thou hast scattered thine enemies with thy strong arm. The heavens are thine, the earth also is thine. As for the world and the fullness thereof, thou hast founded them. The north and the south thou hast created. Tabor and Hebron shall rejoice in thy name. Thou hast a mighty arm, strong is thy hand, and high is thy right hand. Justice and judgment are the habitation of thy throne. Mercy and truth shall go before thy face. Blessed is the people who know the joyful sound. They shall walk, O Lord, in the light of thy countenance. In thy name shall they rejoice all the day, and in thy righteousness shall they be exalted. For thou art the glory of their strength, and in thy favor our horn shall be exalted. The Lord is our defense, and the Holy One of Israel is our King. When thou spakest in visions to the to thy Holy One, and saidest, I have laid help upon one that is mighty. I have exalted one chosen out of thy people. I have found David my servant, and with my holy oil have I anointed him. with whom my hand shall be established. Mine arm also shall strengthen him. The enemy shall not exact upon him, nor the son of wickedness afflict him. I will beat down his foes upon his face, and plague them that hate him. But my faithfulness and my mercy shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted. I will set his hand also in the sea, his right hand in the rivers. He shall cry unto me, Thou art my Father. I'll read that again. He shall cry unto me, Thou art my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. Also will I make him my firstborn, higher than the kings of earth. My mercy will I keep for him forevermore, and my covenant shall stand fast with him. His seed also will I make to endure forever, in his throne as the days of heaven. If his children forsake my law and walk not in my judgments, if they break my statutes and keep not my commandments, then will I visit their transgressions with the rod and their iniquity with stripes. Nevertheless, my loving kindness will I not utterly take from him, nor suffer my faithfulness to fail. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. Once have I sworn by my holiness that I will not lie unto David. His seed shall endure forever, and his son as the throne before me. It shall be established forever as the moon, and the faithful witnesses of in heaven, Selah. That was lengthy, and we could have said a few things here and there. Obviously, each verse is very precious, but what an amazing, amazing psalm that Ethan thinks about all of these wonderful characteristics of Ethan's Heavenly Father, of David's Heavenly Father. But now let's hasten and go to verses 38 through 45, a plea for his chastening. But thou hast cast off and abandoned. Thou hast been wroth with thine anointed. Yes, there is a time because of God's holiness and because of his love that he does chasten those whom the Lord loves, whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. Verse 39, thou hast made void the covenant of thy servant. Thou hast prolonged his crown by casting it to the ground. And the covenant, it seems, from an earthly perspective, has been broken. But it hasn't from a spiritual perspective. We know that the Lord will always have this covenant and will keep this covenant with David. Thou hast broken down all his hedges. Thou hast brought his strongholds to ruin. All that pass by the way spoil him. He is a reproach to his neighbors. Thou hast set up the right hand of his adversaries. Thou hast made all his enemies to rejoice. Thou hast also turned the edge of his sword and hast not made him to stand in battle. Thou hast made his glory to cease and cast his throne down to the ground. The days of his youth hast thou shortened. Thou hast covered him with shame. I personally believe that this is Ethan, the one who was very close to Solomon. And Ethan was actually watching the Lord chasten Solomon for Solomon's wickedness and having 1,000 wives and going away and worshiping different idols. And so Ethan here is pleading for God's chastening. He's saying, Lord, I know the covenant will never be broken because you're God, but I'm watching you chasten Solomon. I'm watching you chasten Israel. Finally, we'll think about in verses 46 through 52, a prayer for his ceaselessness. Knowing Ethan, knowing how faithful God was going to be to Solomon, to David, to the nation of Israel as his father. How long, Lord, will thou hide thyself forever? Shall thy wrath burn like fire? Remember how short my time is. Wherefore hast thou made all men in vain? What man is he that liveth and shall not see death? Shall he deliver his soul from the hand of the grave? Selah. Lord, where are thy former loving kindness, which thou swear unto David in thy truth? Remember, Lord, the reproach of thy servants, how I do bear in my bosom the reproach of all the mighty people. Wherein thine enemies have reproached, O Lord, wherewith have they reproached the footsteps of thine anointed? And then Ethan closes with, blessed be the Lord. And then he says, forevermore. Amen and amen. I believe that Ethan understood what was happening during his time here on earth, watching the Father in heaven chastise his Son here on earth. But I also believe in this last portion of the psalm that he's speaking of hope. Hope of God's ceaselessness in his faithfulness, in his mercy. So we ran through this. I know his assurances, and I trust that this will be a reassurance to you that we have a wonderful Heavenly Father. The affectionate attributes of our Heavenly Father. Let's pray. Father, we do come before you, and we do thank you that you are our Father. We thank you, and we come before you, and we realize that we do not deserve any of your mercy and any of your grace. But we realize that they will never cease in our lives. Not because of us, not because of our faithfulness, not because of our goodness, but because of your wonderful Son's goodness in us. We do thank you for our earthly fathers and for those who have determined in their heart to be godly heavenly fathers. We ask that you would be with them and guide and direct them in their lives. We thank you for the fathers that have gone by the wayside, Father, those that are fallen and are not being who they need to be. We ask, Lord, that you would encourage them to picture you and your wonderful Son in the lives of their children. The United States of America needs righteousness. The church needs righteousness. It needs godly men to stand up and be who they need to be. We thank you, Father, for your attributes in our life that we see. We thank you for the ones that have been highlighted for us this morning in your word. We thank you for Ethan, this godly man who pen this wonderful psalm under inspiration, and ask, Lord, that you would help us to encourage us in our lives, that you are in complete control. We ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.